So we are going live in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. So welcome everybody to Ortho TV and IOA TV. For further proceedings, I'll hand it over to our convener, Dr. Rajgopal sir. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Ashok. Good evening to all of you who have logged in. It gives me great pleasure to welcome you all to this third webinar of Indian Orthopedic Association Postgraduate Teaching Program. Unfortunately, the president and the secretary are busy with another program. I have contacted them. They have asked us to proceed with the program. So we'll go ahead with the program. In absentia, I would like to welcome the president, Dr. Shivashankar, Honorary Secretary, Dr. Naveen Thakkar, President-elect, Dr. Remeshan, and Honorary Secretary, Dr. Lata Srivastava. They will be joining us when they are free. It's also my great pleasure to welcome the two eminent faculty for the day. As you know, today we have kept, we have finished pediatric orthopedics. We have also finished the last week, the other, and now we have come to the spine. To you, the postgraduates who have logged in, I know that most of you are not very happy with the spine case in the exam, or even in PG teaching programs, you have some hesitancy to present the case. I have got for you two faculty whom I know very well, who are, other than being extremely good spine surgeon, they are extremely dedicated teachers, and teachers and examiners for many years, and people who will teach you right from the starting to the A to the Z. Dr. Mallikarjun Swami, who will be giving the first talk on clinical examination of spine, is the professor and head of department of the spine surgery division of Department of Orthopedics, St. John's. We were colleagues before. I know his both my faculty are examiners for not only for MS, they are examiners for even DNB and FNB. Dr. Mallikarjun has been one person who is extremely good in teaching, and he will talk on clinical examination of spine. Dr. Venkatesh, I think known to all of you again, is the professor and head of spine division of Christian Medical College, Bangalore. Is another person who is an all-rounder. He can talk well, he can take class well, teach you well, train you well, and also not only the, I have seen his live demonstrations, it is something to be seen. I don't want to take any more time with that. I welcome my colleagues. Dr. Uday is here, Dr. Paresh is here, and Dr. Subin said he will join later, and Dr. Rajesh also will come a bit later. And also, I welcome all our, the backbone of the team, Dr. Ashok and Dr. Huda, if he is here. And I would like to first, in the absence of the president, etc., I will request Dr. Uday to say a few words, and Dr. Paresh will give the vote of thanks later after the program. Dr. Uday, a few words from you.
Good evening, everybody. And good evening to the all the respected faculty today, Dr. Mallikarjun Swami, and then Dr. Venkatesh, and my colleagues, Paresh Golwar. And then all the post graduates joined today for the third webinar on clinical in the spine. We have two topics today. One is on the clinical examination of spine from Dr. Mallikarjuna Swami sir for the HOD of St. John's Medical College. And then there will be a case discussion from Dr. Venkatesh sir. And then all the orthopedic, future orthopedic surgeons joined today. Now there is a tendency for the all the postgraduates or the junior young surgeons to go for the towards trauma and arthroscopy and arthroplasty. There's a tendency for the from all the postgraduates to just because of the fear of presenting the spine case in the examination, and also in the future also now the, with the neurosurgeons are there waiting in the our competitors for the spine. So I request all of you, even I tell you in our OP, 50% of our cases are spine backache cases. So I request all of you to take up the spine, because there are many fellowships are there in the, given by the IOA and many centers. I urge all of our young surgeons to take up spine spine is definitely a wonderful specialty, a productive specialty. So with these few words, I now request our speakers to take over. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Dr. Malikarjun, can you share your screen?
Yeah. Thank you, sir. In the outset, I'm thankful to IOA and PG Teaching Committee and my mentor, my teacher, Professor Rajgopalan. And it's a nice occasion to speak on spine clinical examination. I love to that. In this occasion, I would like to tell the students that you all know that one volume of Campbell is dedicated to spine, but in MS or DM curriculum, it has not taken into heights actually. Most of the time you concentrate on the hip and trauma. But I think this is the high time you have taken spine as in your selective subject to come out actually, even start with your PG life only. And I will tell you most simplified way of examination of the spine now. So I think this may be suffice to take your exams and other things. Most of the theory things you can read in the clinical textbooks. Yeah, we'll share. Here, some of the slides are there on my own and with our own senior colleagues also. A few clinical photographs from Rajamani also here. I acknowledge that. Of course, we all know that the most important thing is in the spinal examinations is it's like a simple mathematics. You are taking a good history and you are calculating the level of the problems and what the problem it is. More important, careful interpretation of your symptoms and proper interpretation of signs. That's more important. You have to correlate with your data, what you collected, and with your knowledge of anatomy and physiology. And history taking is more important like any other field. How is the pain generated start from here? Pain in the wrist, pain within the dynamic, pain with radiation or not, whether patient has got incapacitated, whether he has got weakness or total paralysis, whether involvement of the bladder, bowel or sexual dysfunction, any constitutional symptoms along with that. And you should take some history regarding anything you are dealing with, then any other organ involvement like a malignancy, like primary, like breast, prostate, lungs, kidney and thyroid. In the history-wise, in the pain, what is the nature of the pain and aggravating relevant factors? We start from the low back, whether it's radiating, whether it's referred, associated with claudication, whether it is has kind of mid-thoracic like girdle pain, whether it's associated with any major weakness, and you have to assess your motor and sensory and both, and whether it's associated the pain with progression, that is more important. And detailed and thorough examination is a customary. And fixed sequence of essential is more important, as I already mentioned. It's like simple mathematics. Physical examination, we are going to methodically in this way, all of you know, inspection, palpation, range of movements of your spine, neurological examination, special test, and vascular examination, and related area examination. Related area examinations mean any back examination, you have to examine the abdomen, vice versa, like other system examination, like lungs. So in inspection, very simple that when the patient is walking in, we should start with the gait actually. Some patient is walking with a gait, what kind of a gait, whether it's having the waddling gait, whether the patient has gotten any, like a robotic gait sometimes. So when the patient is walking with an ankylosing spondylosis, you know that patient has, there is no movement in the spine at all. And the patient having myelopathy is having the hypertonic walk. It's like a robot they will walk. You have to observe on inspection any gibbous, any paraspinal muscle, spasms in a plumb line, in changing the plumb line, coronal curves in a changing, any bony landmarks, whether you can make out. And position of the head is more important, any stiff off deformities, waist triangle, whether it's changed or not, you have to see. It is described beautifully here. And an inspection cutaneous markers, any signs of hemangiomas, hairy patches, neurofibroma, and cephalite spots, whether it is accountable or not, you should know. Again, these are the cutaneous markers, pain and swelling. You should know of any scoliosis associated any bladder and dysfunction. Again, inspection from the side, you have to look for the sagittal curvature, any loss of lordosis, increased kyphosis, like a Stan Simeon, what you see in the picture, any kinds of listasis and swelling. On palpation, come to that, you have to palpate from the top to down, like go in a tenderness in the east spinal levels, look for a paraspinal spasm and tenderness, and directly you can go on the thrust on the spinous process and give the rotational thrust, and you find out the level of pathology, where is the exact tenderness, and look for the muscle spasm. It may be involved in the multiple levels. Sometimes you may hang the tandem lesions. You should, that's why you have to thoroughly examine the cervical spine up to the sacrum. And tapping can be done, spinous process pressure can be done, and you have to look for the movements finally in the flexion and finger floor distance, how can be finger leg distance. You can go for the otosis test, see 6 to see 30 centimeter mark and flex 3 centimeter movement should be there. Schober test and modified Schober test, you all know about that. And you should not forget to look for the chest expansion in all the cases. Coming to the neurological examination per se, you can start with the sensation and motor power, DTR, upper motor neuron and rectal, other reflexes and provocative tests. Most of the textbooks, you mentioned that you start with the motor examination. Purposefully, I put here sensation, because in a quick examination in the exams, suppose you first to find out the sensory level, actually your examination will be, you are more concentrated, can be done. Instead of examining from the upper and lower limb, can come to the sensation by that time, must have lost 10 to 15 minutes. If you start from the sensory, so you know the level and you can fix that level. That's why I mentioned the sensation, although it's not customary in the books. So in sensation, you have to include the 2 point and discrimination and a vibrating, that's more important. And then go to the strength, DTR, upper motor neuron signs, rectal and other reflex and provocative tests. In this manner you have to do. And we all know that there are 33 vertebrae, spinal cord conus and cauda equina, 31 pairs of spinal nerves, 4 flexes, cervical and brachial, lumbar and lumbosacral. And spine and spinal cord, you have to calculate. We all know that because of cervical, you have to add plus 1. D1 to 6, because of the plus 2, you have to add. And D7 and D9, you have to add 3. And D10 level will become L1, L2 roots. 11 will become L3, L4 roots. D12 will be the L5, S1 root. You should not forget this. And lumbar, it will become sacral 2, 1, 3, 4 and coccygeal 1. Because this, you all know anatomy, the orientation of the nerve exit will vary from the cervical to lumbar. And this most important things, the 3 things I mentioned here, that's more important for the orthospine examinations. Apart from, if you know, can better, okay, but at least you should know in the exam point of view. One is Brown-Séquard syndrome. That's most important is loss of proprioception on the same side. And as the injury or lesion and loss of pain and temperature sensation on the opposite side or contralateral side as the lesion. Into the central cord, disproportionately greater motor impairment in the upper compared to lower extremities and variable degree of sensory loss below the level of injury in combination with bladder dysfunction and urinary retention. The third one, called as anterior cervical cord syndrome, is the complete motor loss below the level of the lesion because the anterior cord is involved. Loss of pain and temperature sensation at the below the level of the lesion. As you know, it's retained proprioception and vibratory sensation due to the intact dorsal columns. Sensory examinations, you have to examine because you know two main afferent pathways. Spinothalamic, it carries the pain, temperature and crude touch. Dorsal column proprioception, vibratory sensation and light touch. So touch, position, pain, normal to abnormal, always you have to examine, and segmental to segmental you have to examine. And you have to, the patient should be cooperative for this. It explained, it has to be done in eye closed. and compared to normal if possible. And you have to use the 24 cough 128 Hz. And this is the sensory derivatone. You should be thorough with that. I think you can read. And motor examination, you have to start with the bulk, tone, and power. You know how to grade 0 to 05, reflexes, superficial, and deep. And you know that what is the tone of the muscle? This is the when you rest, the muscle keeps some power in that, isn't it? Without actions, resting muscle arc. This is maintained because of the motor arc. Myotones, for the sake of simplicity, certain muscle groups are identified as representing as a single spinal nerve segment. It has to be tested bilaterally. These muscles, extralinear sphincter, and digital examination is a must. Just getting stuck. Of course, motor examination, you have to start with the proximal muscles in the grooves, distal muscles, single muscle root pattern. What I simplify, I'll tell that you have to better to go with a root, actually, always. When you go distally, you have to go to the single root, like EHL, L5, FHL, S1, like that pattern is very easy for you. Superficial reflexes, coming to that, you have to start with the abdominal reflexes. You have to gently stroke each quadrant, normal response to umbilicus, moving towards stimulus. Absence indicates upper motor neuron deficit. Chromastic replace is more important. Note this point. Absent unilaterally, it indicates lower motor lesion. That is a lesion at the L1 and L2. If it is absent bilaterally, it indicates human lesion. You should not forget to the anal wink to response to gentle stroking on the perianal skin, mediators 2, S2, 3, and 4. Deep tendon reflexes. You have to examine, you have to thorough with that. So you have to start with the ankle S1, knee and L3, and triceps C7, supinator 6, and C5. Of course, in the books, you have gotten one predominant one and predominant one. At least you have to remember thoroughly this. And coming to the pathological reflexes like Babinski, Hoffman's, Oppenheim's, and this is the one, Oppenheim's. Of course, you have to learn this when the patient examiner 89, you have to flex the middle finger flexion. So automatically it can go for the flexion of the other fingers. And Babinski, when you are doing the lateral aspect going up to the base of the metatarsals, the great toe will stand, go up, and other toes will fanning away. That is the typical positive Babinski. Of course, alternative to that, you can have Oppenheim's test, Gordon's test, and Chadwick test. All the alternative to that. UMN, you know that it will be spastic, proximal to D11, failure to store. This is the bladder function. LMN will be flaccid, it will be conus, cauda equina, failure to empty. In a mixed bladder, you may get in between D12 and L1 lesion. Quadriplegia and paraplegia, you have to fix up at the vertebral level and spinal cord level. You have to thoroughly examine the sensory motor, visceral reflex, and the roots. You should remember upper limb examination along the C5, any C6, 7, 8, T1 like that. You should each root, you should have the motor examination and the sensory examination and reflex examination. This is nicely given in the Hoffman field. It has taken from the Hoffman field, you can go through. So like example, C5, when you are testing, you have to test for the deltoid. Like that, alternatively, you can test for the rhomboid also, supraspinatus, infraspinatus, okay, and petrol is major. But clinically, for easy for you, you can go for a deltoid. And some nerve roots may not have any reflexes. You can test only the sensory and motor. And again, lower limbs, you can test for the L4 and L5 and S1 root mainly. You can have the EHL like L4. You can go for the tibialis anterior and knee reflexes and sensory. Like that, you should be thorough with that mathematics. and committing the neuro stress test like a sciatic nerve, like you have few, so many tests, at least for examination point of view. Remember few tests like Nesigu test or Bragard test, Boasting test, cross SLRT and sitting SLRTs. This is a SLRT Lasigu, and when you do the straight leg raising test passively, after the patient start getting the pain, so you have to a little bit reduce at least 5 degrees below that. Again, you have to dorsiflex the ankle. Okay, this is called Lasigu Bragard test. One should remember that this can be done in the sitting position also. In the history wise, I forgot to tell that sciatica, when you call it as any pain radiating from the low back, when it traversing below the knee and going to the calf, then only it is quantified to become called as sciatica. And femoral nerve stress test, okay, should be done in the prone passive extension. You are going to test the L2 and L3 and L4 root. It can happen in the lumbar disc pathology, and it can be associated with psoas abscess, and it can be called as psoas gait. And examination in an entire patient is more important. Look for any lateral bending scoliosis, any sympathetic changes, and any limb length discrepancy is more important. And when you are examining the spine, you always examine the hip is more important. These two are go together and balance together. Of course, you should remember that always examining the vascular examination is a must in all the cases, because you should know how to differentiate between the neurological and vascular claudication. We are all aware that upper limb, you have to examine the distally radial, and lower limb, you have to examine the posterior tibial and dorsalis pedis artery. This is a chart how one can differentiate between the neurological claudication and vascular. So in case of neurological and vascular, palliative will be in the neurological, where you're taking the placing the hip and knee, like sitting, bending and leaning. In case of vascular, just stop walking and taking the rest in standing position, and that's enough, it relieves the pain. And walking uphill is and best for the neurological, because you are flexing the hip and knee. It's very painful for the vascular claudication because it demands become more. Walking downhill is very painful for neurological and painless for the vascular. And bicycle test is painless for neurological, again painful for the vascular. Walking distance is variable in case of neurological claudication and is constant in case of vascular problem. Systemic examination is more important, like already mentioned, general surgical examination, like abdomen examination, genital urinary examination, gynecological and vascular. And coming to the all these things, you have to correlate your clinical findings and your history. Then you have to go for an imaging correlation. Why I'm telling you, first you have to examination, and your findings should fit into your MRI findings or CT findings, whatever it may be. If you go reverse way, what you call it, I falls positive, the spinal pathology. Okay, you may not get anything. What you find, suppose you find EHL weakness. Okay, then you find things of L5 root, you are suspecting the L4-5 level. You should look at the L4-5 disc or any pathology in that level. Suppose if you are suspecting any human lesion, again, D10 or D11, whatever the lesion. Okay, you have to correlate with that level. The MRI finding should correlate. If you go in a reverse way, it may not be useful in your future practice. And radiology, you have to do for the X-rays, even in the dynamic X-rays and general, all the three should be done. CT should be done in 3D, and MRI and contrast soft tissues when you are dealing with an infection and tumors. And message that, most important, it's in good history taking and thorough clinical examination. You should know the basics and rely on your clinical examination, more important. Radiology and investigations only to confirm your diagnosis. The other modalities of investigations like MRI and other things, it's only for precise diagnosis and proper planning for your patient. And thanking you, I think I made it very short, and any questions you can ask me.
Sir, on share screen. Thank you, Dr. Murali, for a very nice, very explanatory, very lucid talk of all the points that the student should know, and very well told, very concise but very effective method. I don't see any questions so far in the chat box. As and when it comes, we'll take it up. I think, hi Rajesh.
Hi sir, hi, good evening. Sorry, bit late, told you.
No problem. Uday and myself are doing things.
Yeah.
Dr. Malikarajan gave a very good talk.
I listened to that.
For the postgraduate students who have logged in, see, I think one of the things that I want to add, Dr. Malikarajan showed a nice, beautiful slide with what are the things you look for in C5, what are the things you look for in C6. Make a picture of this and put it in your classroom or wherever you see it every day. And that's why you keep on remembering that. It automatically comes to your mouth, comes to your mind. So that's the way you remember rather than just learning it and then examining it. There are two ways that you will remember. You just cannot mug up these things. So that's one thing I want to add. Now, Dr. Venkatesh, anything more you would like to add which you think that the student should know? Because Dr. Malikarajan has a limited time given by us. So
I think sir has covered everything, including what to expect and how to pick it up and what are the various things. So as they keep on examining the patient and mapping it, exactly, spine is more almost like mapping only. So you keep on mapping it, you will try to exactly pick it up and where the problem is and what the problem is. So he has given all the outlines, the bullet points. Now students have to take it and go and map it and see on each and every patient to find out where the problem is.
That's why I told customary all the routine, I mean, textbooks have said start with the motor sensory like that.
Yeah.
For in the exams to pick up early, I told to examine the sensory level first, at least.
Yeah.
You'll come to know, point out, then you can go for the motor examination without wasting their time.
Yeah. So I think examination wise, they can check the sensory because it gives them some confidence also.
Correct.
That they are picking up something.
Yes.
But when they are presenting, I think still they should do it in the old format
while presenting, yeah. We start with the motor only.
Yes, yes.
No
yes,
doubt
yes,
about yeah. that.
Like that's what we do in our clinical practice also. When patient yes, comes, yes. We always start with the examination of the sensation.
Correct.
But when we present it in a group, then we go with our routine things. So because definitely it improves your or it's confidence.
No, why in this section I want to request all the students, no? As we all know that so much is written in the orthopedics, voluminous, one volume dedicated Campbell for the spine. Still in the MS or DNB, it has not taken up much. So this is the item I think you have to push our student to learn more and more spine.
Very true, very true, Kamalajit. Because I think that's, even though our clinical knowledge is important, you cannot apply a clinical knowledge without knowing the theory. If
correct.
You do not know where is C5, where is C6, what they are doing, what is the point of examining the patient, you will never realize.
Correct, sir.
Please, Rajesh.
Sir, for examination point of view, I think the spine is one, student has to be thoroughly, see the things. Apart from spine, the other long case is the hip, But the spine, taking apart this examination part, they have to be thorough in the history also. If they don't take a proper history, then I think we will not be going to have examination of the patient. So on history, we can go for differential diagnosis and then we can go on to the examination.
Yes. Yes.
But unfortunately, it is our fault also, teachers and students also. History taking is lacking, they don't know the knack nowadays to take a proper history. History taking is important as far as every aspect of a history is concerned, right from presenting complaints and then past history, family history, everything is important in spine, everything before we take on to the examination.
Yes.
So that is my advice to the students, take proper history. See, when we examine the student, in history we go for the differential diagnosis and so many things and then we go for the examination. And if you don't take how to take a proper history, then there is an issue. Thank you.
Rightly said, sir. You are right.
Yeah.
To Dr. Venkatesh and Dr. Malikarajan, I'm just putting forward some of the questions that are repeatedly asked by the postgraduates to me, which they don't like to put up in a, a meeting. Is that they ask, nowadays we are keeping short case like scoliosis, or sometimes even tuberculosis, I had a place where they are kept it as a short case, expecting them to only look at the spine and give the findings. Now the question students are asking, sir, in a case like that, should we do all the sensations? Should we do all the muscle testing? We will not have enough time. This is the common problem by the students. Should we increase the time or should we reduce the number of tests that we are expecting them from them?
So, sir, I feel, sir, theoretically, they should know thoroughly the theoretical part. Coming to the examination point, not pointing, giving 1 hour extra, half an hour extra is not going to improve the skill of a student. But if you minimize what is really required, see, one should know what is the level of the lesion, what should be the lesion, whether dealing with the post-trauma or infection or congenital, number one. And they should fix up the level, whether it's human lesion or lower or LMN lesion, and what lesion is going on, what is the status. If they come to know, we know, this is a simple mathematics, what I feel. In the exams, if they come to know level of the problem, human or LMN, and what could be the pathology, if they come to that level, personally, I will accept that actually.
Actually, age-wise ailments can also be differentiated. Yeah. And so if you have a younger patient or if you have an elderly patient, and that too inflammatory or infection-wise, that can also be differentiated. So it is better to have differential diagnosis first in the mind and then plan out the examination.
Yes. Sir, you are right in saying your time is very less, especially in a DNV examination. It is only 20 minutes they were giving, you know, earlier. Now they have increased to half an hour. Time is certainly less, but the issue is if you repeatedly examine a patient, you know, when we come in practice, we can examine spine in 2 minutes. There's no problem. But the student, you know, has to thoroughly examine the patient. The more they examine, the more they learn and the acute will be.
Correct.
If they see only two patients, three patients, then it will be difficult for him to, you know, sit in the examination for this. They may take half an hour for history only.
It's a practice of repeatedly doing the test and repeatedly examination.
That is what I'm saying. Yeah. If they can do it, then I think half an hour is enough.
Yes, yes. But at the same time, in DNV last 1.5 years, 3-4 exams going on, COVID exams only.
Yeah.
Yeah, real case, only one case, that took for 15 minutes, that's all.
Yeah, I know.
I think that is the message I want to give back to the students, as I heard from all the faculty on the screen. You have to practice this to students. The only way that you have to practice it, the more and more number of cases you see, you will take lesser and less time. So that is the answer rather than, but also I say that, like Dr. Mallikarjun said, if you are able to do even one test, which gives you what is the idea, what is the level, fine. That's what we are going to ask you. We are not able to have 5 tests to show the same level. That's not necessary. That's so your clinical findings are more important than a very accurate diagnosis.
But then, sir, he should know all the things, no? He should know all the tests. Even where he may demonstrate one, but he should know everything.
Correct. Yes. Correct. Yes, sure.
It's a pinch of salt we are taking the exam.
Yeah, definitely.
You, of course, DNV spine is different. As we all know, it's a different ball game. Anyway, for the MS and DNV ortho, I think this should be the acceptable way. What, Venkatesh, what do you feel?
Venkatesh?
I think with the current system, we cannot get away with short cases because now in FNB, they have taken away short cases and they made everything as the same. But now we cannot get away with short cases. And I think as examiners, we should decide what the students have to examine in that short case, combined all of us together. And we should tell the student to particularly concentrate on that one. And then we should ask questions in that one. I think as examiners, we should have a consensus that in a short case, what we expect from the student, and we should give them an idea that this is what we expect from you. So in the case of, say, for example, in lumbar canal stenosis, where there are no findings, it's purely going to be by history. You have to tell them, you just ask the history alone in this patient and come to a diagnosis, differential diagnosis. In a case of TB spine with neurological deficit, as if it is kept as a short case, we should tell them, examine only the neurological finding. Okay, and then we'll come to a neurological diagnosis. We need not ask about the etiological diagnosis, which we would have got in a history. So these kind of things, the examiners, because we cannot get away with the system. So we have to have a consensus what we should want in a short case.
Yeah, given case scenario, you have to modify. Yes, correct. Yes.
I think that is the, also one of the important things that we have to learn, that overall the method of assessment is changing now with this particular COVID era. You know, we are having also not only the patient, we are having virtual images and putting the patient and discussing, because you were not having the patient because of COVID time. I think we'll also have to learn, probably think of exam pattern cannot remain all the time. But that's not the point of discussion. Point of discussion is that what we are expecting from the students, this is what they want to know, and the feedback has been there with that. Thank you all. I think we will go to the, thank you, Dr. Mallikarjun.
Thank you, sir. If
you are not busy, please stay back, because after the Venkatesh talk again, we will need you, because I have intentionally kept only limited faculty so that the next I invite Dr. Venkatesh to give his talk on, it's a case-based presentation. Intentionally, I have not put the diagnosis anywhere.
Thank you very much. I should, at the outset, I should thank the IOA and Dr. Rajagopal for allowing us to interact with so many faculties and postgraduates, which definitely will improve our teaching skills. So if you go back to our medical college days, when we were doing medicine, and for the final exams, we will all pray that we should get CNS case, because it is so easy to pass in a CNS case compared to CVS or respiratory system. But as we move into orthopedics, we don't want spine case. So we actually want the other cases. In fact, the spine is so easy. Actually, it is like, as Dr. Mallikarjun said, it's like mapping. You have to just keep on mapping it and you will never mix the diagnosis. And unlike other field of orthopedic surgery in spine, 80% of your diagnosis can be arrived on a good history. Okay, and 100% of the diagnosis, or nearly 99.9%, I would say, like the corona advertisements, like we can get the diagnosis after your clinical examination, even before going to your radiological examination. So spine is so easy, actually, and that is what actually made me to come into spine, because I felt that it is, compared to other fields of orthopedics, this is much more easy to examine, arrive at a diagnosis, and it gives you an idea that it correlates with your clinical findings and radiological findings. Well, today I will take up a common case presentation and discussion, which usually is kept for exams. So this is a 30-year-old male, a shopkeeper by job, who has come to us with a mid-back pain for the past 7 months, a difficulty in walking for the past 3 months, and difficulty in micturition for the past 15 days. So these are going to be his chief complaints. So it is very important to elaborate these chief complaints so that you can get each of these things into the history of present illness, so that we can come to a reasonably predictable differential diagnosis at the end of the history itself, as most of the faculty are telling. So he has mid-back pain for 7 months, difficulty in walking for 3 months, and difficulty in micturation for the past 15 days. So when you come to the mid-back pain, this pain is insidious in onset. So you know the various kinds of pain followed by various things, acute pain, insidious onset of pain, gradual onset. Now, this is insidious onset of pain. He gives a history of trauma, but I think that trauma is a red herring, because he says the trauma is actually 3 months before the onset of back pain. But he, because he wants to correlate the back pain, because we all need some initiation or some beginning. We don't believe anything if there is no beginning. So patients will always come and say, I got this back pain because of my trauma, or because of my activity, or because of my lifting weight, or people even will come and say, because I had spinal anesthesia for my cesarean section a couple of years back. So they always will need a beginning, but you have to find out whether this is a red herring or is it a real incidence. So in this aspect, when they said that patient had a pain 2 months back, had an history of trauma 2 months back, and then he had an insidious onset of back pain, we should take that as a red herring. So it's an insidious onset of pain, initially dull aching in nature, and currently it is severe and constricting type of pain. So this this is very important. Like you can't just say that in a history that it is only dull aching nature, because that's what he would have told you initially. But currently the patient must be crying with pain. So you should continue that in the history, saying that initially the pain was dull aching in nature, and currently you have to say what is the current condition of the pain. Currently it is constricting type of pain. This will give you an idea what type of etiology we are dealing with, whether it is a progressive etiology, or it is an acute etiology, or it is a degenerative etiology. So if any patient gives that there is a dull aching pain which is which was gradually progressed and now it is very severe and constricting time, definitely it cannot be trauma and definitely it cannot be degenerative. It has to be more than that. So we have to look, this gives us an idea and the history. And the next thing is, he said his pain has gradually progressed and at present, even at rest, he has pain. This history, we have to really get it, whether the patient has a rest pain or not. Why? Because very few conditions can produce rest pain. Say, for example, neoplasms and infections. Degeneration, very rarely. And a previous history of trauma, like old history of trauma, very rarely has a rest pain. So rest pain is always more towards a sinister thing, like a neoplasm or an infection. And we have to localize the pain. He says the pain is localized and occasionally it radiates to the upper abdomen. So he that also gives the radiation where it is going and where is the localization. So with this localization, you know that it is not in the lumbar spine and it is not in the cervical spine. It is somewhere in the thoracic spine, which is where he says that is in the mid back. And also he says that pain gets worse on any attempted movement of the back. That means it is a very severe problem which is happening now. So if the patient says that a pain is not related to the movement of the back, then you need not worry about many major things, or it has to be more than a non-vertebral thing. And coming to the relieving symptoms, he says pain is moderately relieved with analgesics. That means it is a severe problem and it needs more than analgesics. And also the patient says that it affects the sleep. So with this history, we know that it is a very serious problem and you cannot just give him some analgesics and send him off on this with this patient. The next complaint he gave was difficulty in walking. So in history, we have to very clearly get about the difficulty in walking because it is going to tell you what kind of pathology in the spinal cord we are dealing with. Because at the end, when the patient comes paralyzed, okay, it is difficult to find out what kind of pathology. So only the history is going to tell you what kind of pathology based on and how the progression of the neurological deficit on the history is the one which will give you what is the pathology we are dealing with. It is not the examination. So here you see he has noticed difficulty in walking for the past 3 months. That means it is not an acute onset of difficulty in walking. Initially, he had unsteadiness in walking on uneven grounds. And later he found that climbing stairs has to be difficult. So it slowly progressed. And he also says that he noticed tightness in both the legs and occasional involuntary spasm in the legs of late. So that means it is a gradually progressing and worsening one. It is not an acute onset. And initially, the symptoms were more in the right leg and currently it is bilateral. That means it started in one leg and went to the other leg. So that gives you the symmetry. So that this looks more like an asymmetrical involvement of the spinal cord, which causes difficulty in walking. So, you know, there is a pathology which causes back pain. Okay, definitely it has to be a bony one. And that pathology has progressed and it is causing neurological deficit. That means it is compressing the spinal cord. So it is a bony involvement and also the spinal cord is getting compressed here. So, and at present, what is the condition? So he started with difficulty in walking, but at present he is bedridden and he says that he is able to move his legs in bed, but he is not able to stand or walk due to weakness and tightness in the leg. This history you should get. Whenever you see a patient in his bedridden and he says that I'm not able to walk, you should ask him, why are you not able to walk? So the reasons could be either because of pain in the back, which is not causing him difficulty in walking, but because of the pain, he is not able to walk. The second one is he can have tightness in the legs without any weakness. That means he's able to move the legs, but the legs are so tight that he is not able to walk. The third one is he has weakness and tightness in the leg, and because of it, he is not able to move and walk. The final one could be that he cannot move his legs at all and he is bedridden and he is not able to walk. So all these indicates various progressions of the neurological problem. So this is very important and this we can get only on the history, because when you examine a paraplegic patient, it is not going to tell you whether it was a gradually progressive onset or it is an acute onset. Only the history is going to tell you whether it is a gradual onset of weakness or it is an acute onset of weakness. Why we should know? Because for all that matter, we know that a gradual onset of weakness has a better prognosis compared to a sudden onset of weakness, but has a bad prognosis. So this we can get only on the history, not on your examination. And he also has noticed that he has a reduced sensation, especially to pain below his umbilicus in both the legs, which started in his right leg initially. So this also gives us an idea what is going to be the level of affection in the spinal cord. So this we have to get. If the animation says that I have a reduced sensation, you should ask them some anatomical landmarks, which will give you an idea where to examine this patient. So here the patient says that it is below the umbilicus. Sometimes they can say below the waist. Sometimes they can say below my nipple. And sometimes they will say below my neck. So these are the four areas where they can see, and you should try to get where the sensation is reduced. Because motor is very difficult, because motor you can find out only in the upper limbs and the lower limbs. But sensation you can find out all over the body, and these are the areas where you should notify and tell the ask the patient if he is not able to tell that from where is it reduced, so that when you are examining you don't have to waste time in the upper limbs. You can immediately go at that level and start finding out where the problem is. The last complaint he told was difficulty in urination. So, and he has told that for the past 15 days he has noticed increased frequency of urination. So increased frequency of urination means, like in the spinal cord compression, as Dr. Mallikarjun said, we have to find out whether it is an LMN bladder or a UMN bladder. So increased frequency of urination is more likely to be a cord compression UMN bladder than LMN bladder. This will give you an idea. So if you just say you have any difficulty on urination, it is not going to give you any idea where the spinal cord is getting compressed. Okay, so you have to find out what is the difficulty. It is the increased frequency of urination. There are many conditions which have increased frequency. So how bad is the increased frequency, whether it has totally affected the urinary part or not. The further history will tell you, like he has urgency. Yes, there is some affected. He doesn't have incontinence. He doesn't have dribbling. So it is not a prostate problem. And he doesn't have any feeling of incomplete voiding. And his bowel movements are normal. That means it is an early stage of affection in the spinal cord. So this is what is going to tell you. So if he says, no, I have no urgency, I have increased frequency, but I also have feeling of incomplete voiding and bowel movements are also not normal, that means it is a severe affection. So the prognosis is going to change. So in this patient, you can say the prognosis is better if treatment is started early and initiated early. What are the other associated history you will ask, apart from the history of present, elaborating the complaints which he has told? You have to ask for history of fever, because fever is most commonly seen in infection. So there is no history of fever in this patient. You should always ask for history of significant trauma, not just trauma, okay, which can lead to these conditions. You have to ask for history of loss of weight of appetite, which is more common for chronic conditions like neoplasms and severe conditions like neoplasms and infection. This patient has both loss of weight and appetite. He doesn't have any cough with expectoration, because the commonest problem like this with back pain and neurological deficit is seen with not only with tuberculosis, but also with CA of the lung show. So you should ask for history of cough with the expectoration or with hemoptysis in these patients. This can be also seen in neoplasms like metastasis. So you should also ask for history of hematemesis, altered bowel habits. And you should also ask, how are your upper limbs? So whether upper limbs are normal or not. So this is the associated history you will ask. And this patient had only one significant history where he said history of loss of weight and appetite is there. You should ask for significant past history. So in spine, whether you had similar problem in the past. But when you look at this history, what is the significance you can ask? There is nothing like that. No major significance. But you should know that there are some conditions which could have healed and later causing problems. So like one of the conditions is like late onset of paraplegia and tuberculosis. So in past history, you should ask whether you had a similar problem with or without weakness of your limbs for which you had treatment and you got better. But the deformity worsened, like in a child, and now you have become an adult. He's only 30. So he would have had this problem when he was 12 or 13 and it would have got all right. Now the deformity would have progressed, which is causing the back pain. Okay. And the neurological deficit. So past history is very significant. You should ask for family history, especially for contact history of tuberculosis, because nowadays, like 1 in 3 Indians will have tuberculosis. Some form of tuberculosis. So you can't say there is no family history of tuberculosis. You have to get, do you have any known contact history of tuberculosis, which is very important. If it is there, then you should always consider infection as one of the problems in this patient. And the treatment history, you should ask in this patient. The patient doesn't have any treatment history of tuberculosis, but if the patient has taken ATT, these are the things you should ask. How do you find out whether the patient has taken tuberculosis drug or not? Based on the number of tablets, usually it will be 4 and more. Whether he has taken anything before food, because very few drugs treated for back pain are given before food. Okay, and especially rifampicin, because all the other treatment for back pain, they are given after food because they can cause upper GI symptoms. So only rifampicin is given before food. And color of urine and other body fluids, whether there is any change in color. If people give any of these things, then you should know that the patient has had treatment with anti-tuberculosis drugs. And especially why it is important, because that will tell you whether the patient is worsening on still getting tuberculosis drug or not. And if possible, if a patient is intelligent, where most of the patients now, or they will come with a piece of paper, okay, you can ask for a dosage, whether they are taking the correct dose or not. So these are important history. In examination, you do not ask dosage, but definitely you should ask for history of taking ATT. And if the examiner asks you, how did you find out whether the patient took ATT? These are the questions I asked. So I asked about the number of tablets, whether he took any tablets before taking food, and the color of whether there was any change in the color of urine or in the saliva or body fluids. So this is what the expectation from the examiner. The next one is activities of daily living. As an orthopedic examiner, as an orthopedic postgraduate, you should ask all patients, any case, whether it's a short case or a long case, you should ask about ADL. Three things you should ask in ADL is self-care, vocation, and recreation. So, and what is the expectation? In this patient, self-care, he is fully dependent because he is bedridden. Somebody has to take him and leave him at the toilet, or he has to be given a bedpan. So he is fully dependent for his self-care. Vocation, he is totally off vocation. He is not doing his vocation. Recreation, he doesn't have any, he cannot do any recreational activities because of this one. So his activities of daily living is severely affected. This is the word they expect. Yes, sir. The activities of daily living is severely affected because he is fully dependent for self-care. His vocation is totally lost and his recreation is totally absent now. So that is the history. There are a lot of things you can get in the history, other things, but this is the salient history we got from him. So based on the history, you should have these four things. What are the differential diagnosis? What is the type of neurological deficit he has? What is the level of neurological deficit and probably the vertebral involvement he has? And what is his current ADL? So these are the four things which you should get. So based on this history, what is the differential diagnosis you will have? You think probably he is having some kind of a lesion in the spine, thoracic spine, okay, which is probably an infection or a neoplasm. We are not thinking of a congenital problem. We are not thinking of a traumatic problem. We are not thinking of a degenerative problem. Or we are not thinking of a metabolic problem on this patient. We are thinking of only two things. One is a neoplastic problem or an infective problem. If it is an infective problem, what infection he can have? Yes, he can have, the most common is tuberculosis. Okay, very rarely they can have non-tuberculous conditions. You should not think of pyogenic conditions immediately. Non-tuberculous like Brucella, typhoid, those kind of things you should think of, chronic things. Okay, not an acute MRSA septic or pyogenic spondylodiscitis where the patient will be in sepsis. So, and those patients won't be kept for exams also for you. Okay, a patient with an even an MRSA spondylodiscitis won't be kept for exams for you. You can have it as a differential diagnosis, but the topmost differential diagnosis will be either tuberculosis or Brucella or a Salmonella, which are chronic infections where they can be kept for infection. You have for your examination, you have to have some common sense also. Nobody is going to keep an MRSA septic infective spondylodiscitis for you because patient will be in sepsis. So don't tell, what is your differential diagnosis for infection, doctor? Don't tell MRSA. Okay, so you say tuberculosis or brucellosis, or could be Salmonella also infective spondylodiscitis. Very rarely they can have fungal also, you can say. It is possible. So these are the things you should have in differential diagnosis. What is the type of neurological deficit he has, doctor? So you should not say the patient has root involvement. I think the recording is stopped. Should I? Should I continue or the recording has stopped?
I think you can continue, sir.
Okay, fine. So, what is the type of neurological deficit? We all know the patient is having difficulty in walking because of his tightness. It is not an element lesion. It's probably a cord level involvement. So it is a cord level involvement type of neurological deficit. Where is the level of the neurological deficit? Definitely it is not in the neck cervical level. Definitely it is not in the lumbar spine or the cardiac vena level. It is in the thoracic level. So these things we can get from the history, you should get it from the history. And probably where is the vertebral involvement? Is it mid-back pain and maybe somewhere around the mid-thoracic or the lower thoracic region. And you have to tell what is the current ADL, how it is affected. So to summarize this patient, I can say is a 30-year-old gentleman who has 7 months history of pain, presenting with probably a compressive myelopathy with weakness of both his lower limbs, and his ADL is severely affected, maybe infective or maybe neoplastic. This is going to be my summary of my history. Okay, so now based on this summary, I am going to examine this patient. I know this patient is having thoracic myelopathy, maybe somewhere in the lower thoracic spine, and maybe it is infective of neoplastic, so I have to search for the other areas. So I will, and currently his ADL is affected. So I will examine in this part. So coming to the general physical examination, please always start with general physical examination and be very short. Don't keep on elaborating your general physical examination. Then the examiners will get really irritated. So what are the things they need? They want to know whether the patient is lying in the bed whether the patient is comfortable or in discomfort. So that is the main thing. So you can start saying that patient is thin built or emaciated. This patient was lying in bed with discomfort. Okay. And he looked pale and emaciated. His pulse, BP, abdomen was soft, lungs were clear, and no palpable lymph nodes. That finishes your general physical examination. You do not keep on elaborating on your general physical examination. If you find any swelling related to this one, take it in your specific examination and don't elaborate in your general examination. You might find a cold abscess, but that cold abscess should come in your general specific examination, not in your general examination on this patient. Okay, so in this patient, the gait was not assessed. You can say gait was not assessed because the patient was not able to walk. But otherwise, if they are walking, they can have a spastic gait. So that is what examined. So you will have a spastic gait. That's enough. So how do you say it is a spastic gait? That you can read in many textbooks. But that's all is needed. He is having a spastic gait, if at all. But this patient, the gait was not assessed because he was not able to walk. Coming to local examination. Okay, on this patient, the gibbous, he had a gibbous at mid-back corresponding to the subcostal region. So in the inspection, you cannot say T8, T9, T10, T11 and all those things. You have to say some bony prominences which are corresponding to that. If the gibbous it is at the upper back, you have to say whether it is at the spine of the scapula or at the lower angle of the scapula. Or if the gibbous it is at the lower end, in the lumbar spine, you have to say whether it is at the PSIS or at the level of the iliac crest. Okay, so this is what, only these four areas are there. So the gibbous, either you have to say where it is. So either it has to be at the spine of the scapula or at the lower inferior angle of scapula or at the subcostal region or at the level of the iliac crest or at the level of the PSA, dimple of Venus. So the dimple of Venus, you won't have a gibbous. All the other areas you can have gibbous. So this is what it is. In this patient, he had at the subcostal region. The next thing you have to see is know whether there was any paraspinal spasm or swelling. This patient didn't have any paraspinal spasm or swelling. So usually paraspinal spasm is mostly seen in lumbar spine. So not in the thoracic spine because the muscles are very thin there. You may not see a paraspinal spasm, but you can see a swelling there. So then you have to look for swellings in the renal triangle and in the Petit's triangle or in the subcostal region. So they will ask you, usually the commonest question they ask is what are the borders of the Petit's triangle? So you know it is a triangle with a floor. So the medial border is by your latissimus dorsi. The lateral border is by your external oblique muscle. The base is by your iliac crest. Okay. And the floor is the internal oblique muscle. Okay. So this is going to be a Petit triangle and you should be very clear about it because this question will be commonly asked. What are the border boundaries of the Petit triangle? And sometimes you will find a swelling just above the iliac crest, which is the Petit triangle abscess, cold abscess. Where else you can find cold abscess on this patient? You can find on the subcostal region along the ribs. You can even sometimes find on the inguinal region. And sometimes it can trace all the way up to the thigh also crossing the inguinal region. So these are the areas where you can have cold abscess when you have a problem of TV spine in the mid-back region. Okay. So, and this patient on lying down on inspection, we found there was an occasional involuntary spasms of the lower limb. When you see this, definitely you have to differentiate between a fasciculation and an involuntary spasm. Because why fasciculation is seen in motor neuron disease with weakness. Involuntary spasm is seen in myelopathy with weakness. Okay, so fasciculation means only a particular group of muscles will twitch. It won't cause a movement of the entire joint. A spasm means it will cause a movement of the entire joint. That means the patient will be flexing his hip and knee. Okay, so don't use the term fasciculation. That is mainly in the motor neuron disease where you will have a twitching of the muscles, group of muscle, which doesn't cause any movement of the joint. Here, the joint will move. Okay, so that is an involuntary spasm. What is the inference of it? When they have an involuntary spasm, that means the compression of the spinal cord is severe. Okay, or it is chronic. That is what the interpretation of involuntary spasm. Okay, so on palpation of this patient, he had a gibbet as mid-back with T9 being the most prominent spinous process. So when you talk about deformity in the spine, especially in a kyphotic deformity, what are the types of kyphotic deformity you can have? You can have either have a gibbous or you can have a rounded kyphosis. Angled kyphosis, or you can have a rounded kyphosis. So these are three things. A gibbous means less than three vertebrae is involved, and there is a knuckle. That means one spinous process is prominent. Gibbous means less than three vertebrae are involved, three and less, and there is one spinous process which is prominent. Angled kyphosis means 3 to 8 vertebrae are involved, and more than one spinous process will be prominent. Okay, in a rounded kyphosis means it is more than 8 vertebrae, 7 to 8 vertebrae, more than 7 vertebrae are involved, and there will be multiple smooth spinous process which will be prominent. So what are the conditions? Gibbous is commonly seen in infection or in trauma. Okay, in or in, very rarely in neoplasm, which causes dislocations. So these are things very commonly in infection, which is TB, very rare, and sometimes you will see gibbous in trauma, in neglected trauma, like an fracture dislocations, and very rarely in neoplasm, which causes dislocations. A rounded kyphosis usually seen in conditions like Schumann's kyphosis, which is like a chronic conditions, okay, like a congenital conditions, and in a multiple levels of tuberculosis, very rarely in multiple levels of tuberculosis. In olden days we used to see, but nowadays we don't see rounded kyphosis in tuberculosis because of early diagnosis and treatment. Where will you see angled kyphosis? Where will you see rounded kyphosis? Rounded kyphosis is usually seen in ankylosing spondylitis with a deformity. So these are the three things. So here the patient had gibbous at mid-back. Whenever you say a gibbous, you have to say which spinous process is prominent. Usually the lower spinous process will be prominent in most of the patients. Why? Because when the upper vertebra collapses, the trunk also moves forward a little bit. So usually it is a lower spinous process which is prominent. So why it is important? Because, you know, if it is a T9 with prominent spinous process, the involved vertebra will be T8 and above. It cannot be T9 and below. Very rarely it can be T9, but it cannot be below T9. So your neurological deficits also should correspond to that spinous gibbous. Okay. Then the next one is the patient had thrust tenderness over the gibbous. Okay, so because the gibbous will be usually, the spinous process usually will be painless. Spinous process won't be painful, but that vertebra affected is in the front. So you have to get a thrust tenderness. So this patient had a thrust tenderness over the gibbous and there was no palpable swelling. If you suspect a patient who has neurological deficit and thrust pain when there is a gibbous don't check for range of movements, because it is not advised to check the range of movements when the patient has neurological deficit. But otherwise, in this patient, anyway, the neurological range of movements could not be checked due to pain. What is the neurological movement range of movement you will check in thoracic spine? Thoracic spine does not have any flexion and extension. So the only movement you can check is the rotation. There are rotation and the lateral flexions. Okay, so that is these are the movements which you can check. So don't say about flexion and extension in thoracic spine. Always talk about rotations in the thoracic spine. And likewise, in the lumbar spine, what are the movements you can check? You can check always the flexion and extension and lateral flexions, not rotations, because practically there are no rotations in the lumbar spine. It is only flexion and extension. So don't talk about, when you say what movement will you check in the thoracic spine, don't start with flexion extension. It is always rotations in the thoracic spine. Special tests, especially nerve root test signs, are not tested in this patient because it is not relevant. Don't keep on telling SLRT was negative and Faber's was negative, Lessig's was negative, pump handle test was negative, and all those things. In this patient, you can say it is not relevant and it was not tested. Special tests like nerve root tension signs. Yes. So this is the general examination and specific examination. Once you get over with the specific examination, then you come to the neurological examination. So if you go back to the specific examination, the only positive finding was gibbous, occasional involuntary spasms, and tenderness over the gibbous. Only three were positive on this patient. So don't spend too much time on elaborating your findings on these three examinations, which is the inspection, palpation, and the special test. Okay, fine. Coming to the neurological examination on this patient. So it's always start with how the patient, whether he was cooperative or not. It is very useful in all spy examinations of any examination, because that will give you an idea how difficult was it for you to elicit the finding on this patient. Okay, so patient was cooperative, he was conscious, and he was oriented to time, place, and person. Will finish your higher mental function test. Cranialness, yes, for all spine patients, make it as a routine at least to check the optic, the vision, whether your vision is all right, trigeminal, whether your sensation in the face is all right, especially the lower end of the face, facial nerve, whether there is any asymmetry or not, and any deviation in the tongue and all those things, hypoglossal, because when you have a cervical spine, these things matter, especially the trigeminal, facial, and the hypoglossal nerve testing. But otherwise, cranial nerves, you can say normal. If they say, why do you say, doctor, normal? Because I asked for vision, sir. I looked at his tongue, it is normal, and there was no facial asymmetry, and there was no sensory disturbance in the face. That will be enough. You don't just blink that, saying that I have not examined anything in detail. You don't have to examine anything in detail. This is an orthopedic spine examination. This is not a neurologic examination. Okay, but at least you should know what are the minimum things you will examine for cranial nerves. Coming to motor then. As said earlier, you can always start with sensory, but when you're presenting, always start with motor. What are the things you will notice in motor is bulk, tone, motor power, and reflexes. So in this patient, bulk was reduced and wasting was seen in the thigh and calf. Obviously, it is a long-standing process. Tone, patient had hypertonia. So how do you examine tone? You have to catch the lower limb around the ankle, support the thigh, the lower end of the thigh, and slowly flex and extend the leg. And you have to count what is the speed you have to do is you have to say 1001, 1001, 1001. And that is the speed you have to do. 1001 flex and extend, 1001 flex and extend. So that is the speed you are going to see. In most of your cases, especially in compressive myelopathy, what kind of hypertonia you will get is a clasp knife rigidity. That means at the beginning and the end, you will have rigidity. Very rarely, you will have a lead pipe rigidity. You will be never kept a cogwheel rigidity because that is usually seen in Parkinson's. So the commonest one you will get is a clasp knife rigidity in any compressive myelopathy, especially in tuberculosis of the spine. So how do you examine tone? You catch the lower end of the ankle, lower end of the leg, hold the lower upper posterior aspect of the thigh and try to flex the hip and knee. Hey, when as saying 1001, and you will feel resistance in the initial part and the terminal part. So that is a clasp knife rigidity you will get usually seen in compressive myelopathy. Then this patient had hypertonia. The next one is coming to motor power and reflexes. Coming to the motor power, this patient had around 3 and 4/5 MRC. So these are the things you have to see. Like hip flexors usually correspond to L2. On this patient, if possible, we made him sit and test it. Because if the patient has severe back pain, you cannot do an ask the patient to lie down and lift his leg for his hip flexor. It will be very painful in the back. So if the patient can sit, always make the patient sit and check the hip flexor, especially if you have a TB spine, because otherwise it's very difficult for him to lift the leg. It will cause back pain. The same way knee extensors, you can ask them to make him sit and do it. That will be very easy rather than trying to make the patient lie down and do it. So if you are given a TB spine case or a case where the patient is having significant back pain, try to do hip flexors and knee extensor in sitting position rather than trying to do it in lying down position. But always note it down. If a patient has an SLR positive, sitting and doing a knee extension will be difficult because that will reproduce an SLR. I will tell again, if the patient has a positive SLR, if your case is a disc prolapse case and the patient has a positive SLR, the most common problem you will notice is when you examine his knee extensor, okay, it will be like reproducing an SLR. So, and it will be always a wrong answer. Like you won't get a proper examination of the knee extensor. So if your SLR is positive for some reason, which you have got it in your special test, always make the patient lie down in prone position and check the knee extensor. So that won't reproduce an SLR. And you will get the knee extensor power exact. Otherwise, what will happen with an SLR positive? If you make the patient sit or lie down and check the knee extensor, it will be like reproducing the SLR and you won't get a positive proper power of the knee extensors. Then come to ankle dorsiflexors and then EHL, EDL, ankle avertors. All these things you have to check. Okay. And you in this patient, we found it is around 3/5. Okay, fine. Then coming to the reflexes, this patient had an exaggerated knee reflex, exaggerated ankle reflex. He had an app. He also had a patellar and ankle clonus. I'm sorry, I didn't put it here. He had a patellar and ankle clonus, which was positive on this patient. His abdominal reflex was absent in the superficial reflex. Then come to superficial reflex. His abdominal reflex was absent in the lower abdomen. Cremastic reflex was absent and plantar was upgoing. So this one, you should not miss it. Like when you have an exaggerated knee reflex and an upgoing plantar, please don't say it is a radiculopathy. It is a myelopathy. That means the compression is in the spinal cord, not at the root level, even though the patient has, you go see weakness of these hip flexors, weakness of his ankle dorsiflexors, weakness of his EHL, EDL. Don't say it is a root level involvement. because these things start from the spinal cord and he has an exaggerated reflexes. All human signs are positive here. Exaggerated ankle reflex, exaggerated knee reflex, clonus positive, plateal and ankle clonus, abdominal reflex is absent, the lower abdominal reflex, chromacic reflex is absent, plantar is upgoing. So don't say that the weakness of the knee and hip flexors and the ankle dorsiflexors are because of root involvement. It can still happen with cord involvement. Fine. So then coming to the sensory examination, you have to check light touch, you have to check pin prick. These two things are mandatory. For examination, you should always check joint position sense and you should always carry a tuning fork, 128 hertz tuning fork, and check the vibration. These four things you should check. If you are very good, you can always ask for a temperature, which we will always say, doesn't matter, don't check temperature. So always ask a skilled assistant, sir, can I check the temperature also? So these are the things like sensory examination, light touch, pin prick, joint position and vibration. Why these things? Because you know light touch, joint position, vibration are posterior column and pin prick and motor are anterior column. So you know where the compression is. So in this patient, you can see that the reduced sensation for pin prick from T12 downwards, you are getting a sensory level. In fact, T11 downwards. In fact, from T11 onwards, he had reduced sensation by around 50%. Light touch was slightly reduced, less than 10%. Joint position sense was reduced in lower limbs. That means it was equivocal. Sometimes he was able to tell, sometimes he was not able to tell. Vibration was grossly reduced in this patient. If you come to the den, do the perirectal examination. There is anal tone was normal, anal wink was normal. Voluntary anal contraction was reduced and perianal sensation for the light touch and pin prick was reduced in this patient. So other joints always and systems examined. His bilateral SI joints were normal, hip joints and knees were normal. Always check for the lower limb pulses because you won't know. It may not be for examinations. Dissecting thoracic aneurysm can present in the same way, except that gibbous deformity. Except gibbous, dissecting thoracic aneurysm can have back pain, severe back pain. They can have these kind of neurological findings. But only thing is, they will have an absent lower limb pulses. They may not have exaggerated reflexes, but they can have an absent reflexes. Okay, so you always check for the lower limb pulses on these patients. So at the end of the diagnosis, at the end of your clinical examination, how do you arrive at a diagnosis? The diagnosis usually arrived based on the neurological level. That means whether it is a myelopathy or a radiculopathy or a combined problem. If it is a myelopathy, whether it is an extradural or intradural, okay, then the level of neurological involvement, what is the uppermost level, affected level, whether it is a vertebral or a non-vertebral problem which is causing this neurological problem. If vertebral, what is the level and probably the etiology, and finally, the functional staging. So what is the function? Whether you have to quote the clinical stage based on Neurich or based on ACEA or based on Kumar and Tully classification. Okay, one of these things you should have. All these things should be combined on your exam history. So on your diagnosis. So this is how you write your diagnosis. So put this tabular column or write all these things and then see what this patient has. So this patient, yes, he has myelopathy. Yes, he has an extradural myelopathy. Why? Because he has an asymmetric involvement. In intradural myelopathy, usually it will be symmetric involvement. There is further differentiation you can do with an intradural, whether it is an intramedullary or extramedullary. That is not important. At least you should know whether it is an extradural or intradural. How do you differentiate? It is an asymmetric presentation. If the patient says both limbs started at the same time and ascended upwards, definitely it cannot be extradural. And your examination case usually won't be like that. It will be asymmetry only. Like one leg it starts and comes to the other leg. And sometimes one leg will be having more sensory symptoms, other leg will have less sensory symptoms, and vice versa in motor also. So it is extradural myelopathy. Level of neurological involvement, yes, sensory is T11. I wrote it as T12, but actually this patient at T11 was the most affected. Motor is L2 and reflexes is T11 because the lower abdominal reflex were absent. Okay, that is T11 and T12. So this is the sensory. If it is vertebral, yes, he had a gibbous. So if it is gibbous, means the most prominent level is T9 and lower down is T8. So, and you know, if it is T8 vertebra, okay, so three levels down can be affected. So that corresponds to your sensory level, T11 also. So, you know, like how this vertebral level corresponds to your more sensory level also here, sensory and reflex level. Then finally, etiology, what could be the etiology? It could be either infective or neoplastic. And if you see the functional stage, it could be Kumar and Tuli stage 3, or it could be Neurik stage 5, or it could be an ACRC. So this tabular column you should put for your diagnosis before writing the final diagnosis. So once you put this tabular column, now we can see what is the final diagnosis you can write for this patient on for your exams. So before that, I'll just tell you what is the Kumar and Tuli classification. As in, one is negligible, patient is unaware, plantar extensor and ankle clonus. This patient is stage 3 because he is non-ambulatory. He is paralysis, that means he is paraparetic in extension. He has a sensory deficit of less than 50%. So that's why I put it as Kumar and Tuli stage 3. So his diagnosis will be T11 extradural compressive myelopathy due to T8-T9 infective spondylodiscitis, probably due to tuberculosis with stage 3 paraplegia of Kumar and Tuli, or you can say Neurik 5 thoracic myelopathy. So this will be his complete clinical diagnosis after your examination. If you are not very sure about this extradural compressive myelopathy, you can always use the term T11 paraparesis. Okay, even though it doesn't sound very nice, it knows that you are not an expert, but still it is acceptable. I think most of the faculty will accept this one. You can say T11 paraparesis due to T8-T9 infective spondylodiscitis, probably due to tuberculosis with stage 3 paraplegia of Kumar and Tuli, or you can say Neurik 5 thoracic myelopathy. So if you get a gibbous, please, and if you think it is infective, please try to use Kumar and Tuli staging there, because it makes very simple, it makes us easy to understand what is the problem with the patient or how severely he is affected now. You don't have to keep on elaborating that he is bedridden and all those things. Kumar and Tuli stage 3, anybody will understand that he is bedridden. Okay, if you say stage 2, all of us know that he is walking with support. So if you say Neurik 5, you don't have to elaborate on his ADL. We know all, it is bedridden. So you don't have to keep on elaborating on your diagnosis, saying that he is bedridden and he is ADL is affected severely for self-care and all those things. Okay, so this is what we expect. So now I stop here. I request Dr. Rajagopal to add anything more which has to be included on your diagnosis or on your clinical examination.
Thank you, Dr. Venkatesh.
Sorry, it is not over yet. I have to continue on the management.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah,
I continue on the management. Up to this level.
I think I really feel I don't have anything more to add, but I agree with you. But Mallikarjun, I want to think that anything more, that is before we go into further confirmation of diagnosis. Yeah.
Yes. So any from senior faculty, anything else you would like to hear in the diagnosis? Like most of you will go as examiners for a TB spine case. Anything else?
Most of the times, the problem is how do you pronounce the diagnosis? That is the problem.
Yes.
Anyway, you made it very clear. This is how you have to pronounce the diagnosis.
Yes.
At the end of the examination.
Yeah.
So everybody, the examination asks the student, what is your probable diagnosis, clinical diagnosis?
Yeah.
So this is the way one has to pronounce the diagnosis. Yes, sir. Thank you. Very. This is what is important for the postgraduate.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. So now I'll go to management. So next question they will ask you, what is the management?
Just a minute. Dr. Mallikarjun wanted to say something, please.
Oh, sir. Yes, sir. Sorry.
Everything is fine, sir. Of course, it's very precise diagnosis. Of course, FNB candidates would do like this, no doubt. And for the post, infective pathology, Kumar and Tuli classification is very fine. Actually, personally, I feel. For the trauma purpose, they can use the ACR.
Yes.
I prefer, actually. Yeah.
Now, what he says is perfectly correct. I think for infection, we should all go back and use that staging so that it is uniform. We understand what is the problem for the patient.
Correct. Yes.
Yeah.
I too agree to that.
80%, I think it will fit into the diagnosis. There are some cases which may not fit, but we won't keep those cases for examination.
That is the most important point. Please, we will not keep for you something which even I do not know. Keep for you only things are very clear. Carry on, Magnesh.
Yeah, fine, sir. So coming to the management, don't immediately jump into I'll do surgery, because I know many of you may have known the case before. Okay, and don't jump and say that, sir, I will try to do an operation and all those things, which is quite commonly seen even after the hip case. Like once you say chronic arthritis, then what will you say? What will you do? You'll do a total hip replacement. So don't jump like that. You always start with investigation. Management starts with investigations. In fact, in a FNB or in a specialty fellowship, management starts with immediate pain relief. So you have to start with, so I've seen the patient, I'll give him pain relief first and then ask for all these investigations. You cannot ask the patient to live with pain till all the investigations are completed. So here are the investigations, complete blood count. What is the role for complete blood count? In chronic diseases, they can have anemia. Okay, in cases of any other neoplasm, it can show some variations. And also there will be a lymphocytic predominance and in cases of tuberculosis, which is chronic. So most thing is hemoglobin we have to see, which is going to be a chronic feature of anemia. And some patients may need even blood transfusion because the anemia is so severe on these patients. Unless you do blood transfusion, I'm not talking about surgery, even for non-operative management. Okay, for them to be well, for them, your drugs have to act and all those things, they need a good hemoglobin. So hemoglobin is not only for surgery, it is also for non-operative management in TB spine. And then most of these patients on chronic disease, they will have ESR will be improved. Yes, CRP also is required. You can also tell CRP, but in a chronic case, if it is more than 3 weeks, okay, because CRP is an acute phase reactive protein. So technically speaking, more than 3 weeks, it should not be positive. It should have come down. So in this patient, since it is 7 months, that the reason for doing CRP is very limited unless we are thinking of a pyogenic spondylodiscitis. So here it is, ESR is more important than CRP. Then chest x-ray, please always mention chest x-ray, because why? TB spine is osteoarticular tuberculosis is a secondary tuberculosis. Okay, it is not primary. So osteoarticular tuberculosis is secondary. So there is some other primary focus. So if it is in the thoracic spine, the primary focus has to be either from the lymph nodes around the thoracic spine or from the lung. Okay, so the lung easily we can find out. If it is in the lumbar spine, always do one, examine the abdomen, look for any doughy feeling and all those things which are susceptible of a tuberculosis spondylitis, tuberculosis abdomen. So here the chest x-ray is important. And you look for any problem, lesions in the chest x-ray. Then please ask for if the patient has cough. This patient doesn't have cough. Otherwise, the patient, if your patient has cough, also please tell that I will also do a sputum AFB. I will also do a Mantoux test if the patient is young, less than 20 years of old. I will do a quantiferon gold if you are from a area where TB is not very common. Okay, so in our country, it doesn't matter because all of us have some antibodies for tuberculosis. There's no point in doing quantiferon gold. Okay, but if you are a postgraduate from Andaman Nicobar or from Lakshadweep, where TB is not common, and if you find infective spondylitis, then there is justification of doing a quantiferon gold. So otherwise, there is no big justification in doing it. So in this patient, the only positive finding was an ESR, which was raised, which was 52 mm. Okay, so all the others were normal. So don't say be surprised that many a times, that means almost 60 to 70% of the time, we may not be able to find a primary source. Why? Because TB can happen even after 1 to 9 years after your primary disease has healed. So a secondary tuberculosis, secondary osteoarticular tuberculosis can happen even somewhere between 1 to 9 years after the primary focus has healed. So you don't be surprised that you may not find any primary focus. So then you come for the specific thing. You say you will ask for an x-ray of the, don't say x-ray of the spine, specifically mentioned in this patient, lower thoracic spine, AP and lateral. So here I have zoomed it. And what are the things you will see? So you can see a focal osteopenia. Like, I don't know whether you've seen this pointer, but you can see focal osteopenia here on this patient. You can see the disc space is narrow at this level. And you can see there is a bird's nest abscess, which is tracking upwards on this patient on the AP view. So these are the classical findings of infective spondylodiscitis. So don't mix up these things with tumors. Can you have a tumorous condition like this? Can you have a neoplasm like this? Very, very, very unlikely. In fact, in my 20 years experience of managing spine patients, I have seen only one patient with a bird's nest view and a thing like this, which turned out to be a telangiectic osteosarcoma. And even in that patient, the disc phase was preserved. It was published, but even there, the disc phase was, here you can see the disc phase is absent, narrow. So don't say this is neoplasm. This is infection. This is not trauma. This is not a tumor. This is pure infection. Okay, can it be a congenital lesion? No, because there is no hemivertebra. Even though you see something like a hemivertebra on the lateral view, it is not seen on the AP view. Okay, so it is not a congenital lesion also. It is very clear that disc space is narrow, is absent here. You can see one bone is touching the other bone. You can see multiple bones are involved. There is a kyphosis and there is an abscess collection on both sides like a bird's nest view. Okay, so this is not tumor or trauma, this is infection. In tumor, the additional finding you can see will be that there will be a winking owl sign. That means the pedicles will be involved. You may not see the pedicles on the tumor. So this is not tumor. This is infection, infection, infection. What are the classical features of infection? Focal osteopenia. Yes. Second is narrowing of the disc space, absent disc space. The second one. Third one is kyphotic deformity. That is the third one. Fourth one is the paraspinal abscess, paravertebral abscess. These are classicals of infection on it. So even an X-ray can find out an infection. You don't have to always go for an MRI. So what are the indications to an MRI on a patient with infection? Is when the patient has a neurological deficit, you want to see something more, which will give you an idea why this patient. If the patient doesn't have a neurological deficit, this is sufficient to come to a diagnosis for a infective spondylodiscitis. Okay, whether it is TB or something, which you have to do it with a microbiological diagnosis, but for you to diagnose, this is more than enough. So now, then, what will you see on the MRI? Why we do an MRI, I told you, it's mainly to see any additional features, why it is causing infection, why it is causing neurological deficit. What are the things you'll do? See in MRI, so apart from knowing whether it is a T1 weighted or a T2 weighted images, which you will learn, you have to see these things on an infective spondylodiscitis. One, epidural abscess, two, intraosseous abscess, three, paravertebral abscess, four, soft tissue abscess like psoas abscess, five, disc space involvement, six, posterior ligaments involvement. Very clear. This is all we have to describe on MRI. So if any examiner asks you what are the things you see on the MRI, immediately say what is the level first. Okay. After saying the level, to immediately go say what is the, whether it's a T1 or T2. Well, you can say, sir, this is a T2 weighted image of the patient. Okay. Level, as you know, there is a T8, T9 and T10 is involved. And you can see there is an epidural collection here, epidural abscess. Yes, there is an intraosseous abscess here, sir. There is a prevertebral abscess, which is seen on the lateral view and on the axial views. Okay. The posterior elements are not involved. And there is a disc space involvement. That's all is needed. So, and it says, yes, what is it? Infective spondylodiscitis. Can it be a tumor? No, because the disc space is involved. Can it be a trauma with the blood? No, because again, the disc space is involved and there is a destruction of the vertebra. Can it be a tumor? Very unlikely, because the posterior elements are preserved to the amount of anterior destruction of the patient, what he has. Okay, so it is not tumor. So it has to be infection. So that is what you see on the MRI. Now, how do you manage infective spondylodiscitis or TB spondylodiscitis who has paraplegia, tetraplegia? So you always, if go with the CT-guided biopsy, and if the culture, if it says that as a TB, or if it is an expert which shows TB, you start ATT under supervision, the rest for 3 to 6 weeks. If there is progressive recovery, continue ATT. If there is no recovery, then you go for surgical decompression. This is the classical Tully's middle path regime. Okay, this you should know. Okay, so where they ask, what is Tully's middle path regime? It means that once the patient comes and you identify, you think there is an infective spondylodiscus or maybe because of TB, you always attempt to prove the diagnosis. You need not operate on this patient. You do a CT-guided biopsy. Okay, and send it for expert tuberculosis. You can send it for MGAT once and start on ATT and supervision and rest. The patient shows progressive recovery, continue ATT. If there is no recovery, patient needs a surgical decompression. This is the classical Tully's middle path regime. This you should know. Okay, fine. So what are the things you have to send the tissue for or the pus to be sent for? Expert TB you have to send. You have to send for Gram staining, which was pyogenic spondylodiscitis can also be seen. Okay, you have to send for AFB smear, Zeal-Nielsen's technique. Okay, because sometimes even if the expert is negative, AFB smear could be positive. And you have to send it for MGIT. What is MGIT? Is mycobacterial indicator tube, which is a rapid test. Or if your place doesn't have, you have to say for LG medium. That is a Lowenstein Jensen's medium. LJ. I'm sorry, it is not LG, it is LJ, LJ. It is not G. So LJ medium. Always send the tissue for histopathology, because sometimes if you don't get any of these things in histopathology, still you can get necrotizing caseating granuloma. Okay, so necrotizing granulomatous inflammation, caseating necrosis are more in favor of tuberculosis than anything else. So even if you're not getting any of these things positive, histopathology can pick it up and you can come to a diagnosis of TB. Okay, fine. So how do you manage this patient currently in the current situation? So for that, you should know what is the cause for the neurological deficit. What are the indications for operative and non-operative management? What are the types of operative management? How long the duration of ATT should be given and how long you should follow up this patient? These are the basic principles in managing a TB spine. So what are the causes for the deficit in TB spine? It's very simple. It's inflammatory, mechanical, intrinsic, and spinal tumor syndrome. Okay, so inflammatory can be because of edema, granulation, abscess, caseous issue, mechanical, intrinsic. So in this patient, what do you think is the reason? So in this patient, probably the reason is inflammatory combined with mechanical. So why we should know? Because if it is mechanical, okay, treating alone with tuberculosis may not help in recovery, or it may take a long time. If it is only inflammatory, say for example, edema or a granulation or an abscess or a caseous issue, okay, without a debris or a sequestra or a stenosis or an internal gibbous like how you saw in this patient on the MRI, okay, so still you can treat it with AITT. So only an early stages, okay, where you don't have much of an abscess or a debris, you can treat these patients non-operatively. Otherwise, you have to treat them operatively. So knowing the cause for deficit is very important. If the patient comes with late, say for example, stretching or patient has a dislocation, then there is no point in treating these patients non-operatively. And if the patient has an extradural granuloma or a tuberculoma or a peridural fibrosis, there is no point in treating these patients non-operatively. You have to treat them operatively. Okay, so you have to know what is the cause for the deficit. The second one is, you know, there are some things called absolute indications, indications for surgery called absolute indication, relative indication, rare indication. You know, when this was described, as early as 1935 by Seddon. Okay. And if you see the first article, first Campbell, which came up in 1960 by Crenshaw. Okay. So he has mentioned this absolute indication, relative indication, rare indication. For exam purpose, you should know. But we should also know what is the current indication in management. So for exam purpose, I will tell you what are the absolute indications: paraplegia with uncontrolled spasms, severe paraplegia of rapid onset, any severe paraplegia of flaccid inflection, complete loss of more than 6 months. Okay, relative indication is recurrent paraplegia, old age, painful paraplegia, and all those things, and rare indication. So this is for your exams. But what is the most important thing is you should know what is the present main indication. Okay. Which is the what your examine your factor your fact your examine your teachers in your center will be doing is for significant neurological deficit with or without ATT. Okay, whether the patient is on ATT or not on ATT, when the patient has significant neurological deficit, you have to operate this patient. You cannot put them on ATT alone unless the patient's life is so risk that you cannot operate. Very rarely that will happen, especially in a patient who is coming with 80 or 90 years of age. Okay, and you say that you are not going to operate this patient and you are going to try this. Otherwise, for all people who have a significant neurological deficit with or without ATT, you have to operate. The second one is failure of response at 3 to 6 months. You don't keep on continuing on ATT on these patients. You try to debride as much as possible and then operate and give a good stability so that the patient can heal. This is the failure of response at 3 to 6 months ATT. The third one is doubtful diagnosis. Don't keep on treating the patients with tuberculosis drug, ATT drug. When you have a doubtful diagnosis, patient is not improving, please operate and then find out the diagnosis and treat the patient. Mechanical instability after healing. Okay, you cannot do non-operative management on this patient. You have to operate on this patient. Recurrence of disease with neurological deficit. It could be MDR tuberculosis. So please do operative management on this patient. And to prevent kyphosis, especially in children, you have to operate. If the patient needs an anterior transfusion of the cord, especially in late onset of paraplegia, you have to operate. So these are the present main indication. And this patient falls into the first indication, that is for significant neurological deficit, even without ATT. Don't try ATT on this patient because he has significant neurological deficit. And the patient's chances of improving are more with your surgical treatment than with non-operative management. So what are the surgical options in managing infective spondylodiscitis like TB spine? Before starting that, I would say, don't say laminectomy, because laminectomy alone is absolutely contraindicated in TB spine unless it is a posterior only disease. Okay, so for postgraduates, please note it, laminectomy should not be done. It cannot be done as a standalone procedure. It has to be combined with some other procedure, which we will see. So laminectomy alone should not be done. So don't say, how will you operate? Sir, I will do a laminectomy. Because for many of the surgeries, that is the first procedure you would have seen. Okay, so don't use that word for infective spondylodiscitis. Okay, so what are the surgeries you can opt for is costotransvasectomy. So this was described as early as 1894. What is that? To prevent the recurrence of the abscess, it is important to trace the abscess to its source. What is costotransvasectomy? You know, the rib has two articulations. with the vertebra. One is with the transverse process and another one with the body. So disarticulating these two is called the costo transverse ectomy. So where you take out the rib at the and the transverse process, okay, there you disarticulate the costo transverse joint. And when you take out the rib close to the vertebra, you take out the costo vertebral joint. So what is a costo transverse ectomy? Practically means it is taking out the rib and the transverse process and disarticulating the costo transverse and the costo vertebral joint is called costo transverse ectomy. What will happen once you do that? It will go to this anterior space where you have the abscess and it will drain. So a costo transverse ectomy is not a decompressive procedure. It is a drainage procedure. Okay, it doesn't decompress the spinal cord. So if you want to decompress, so don't use the term costo transverse ectomy alone on this patient just because you see a lot of abscess in the axial view. Okay, because it is only a drainage procedure. You have to decompress the spinal cord. So what is the procedure you can do? It's called anterolateral decompression. And many of you will think an anterolateral decompression is an anterior procedure. No, it is a posterior procedure. It is done from the back. Okay, how you do it? Norman Kapner has described. You can read it in your textbooks. So, but basically, it is like, apart from doing a costo transverse ectomy, you also take out the damaged pedicle and part of the vertebra from the back, which will decompress the spinal cord. So, apart from doing a costo transverse ectomy, you do a partly take out the pedicle and also the part of the rib, which will decompress spinal cord. And mind it, you don't do a laminectomy. See, the lamina is intact. Both in costo transverse ectomy and in anterolateral decompression, don't do a laminectomy. So this is a decompressive procedure. Okay, so at least you should say, I will do an anterolateral decompression on this patient. Yes, it is justified. But people will say, there is a kyphosis. There is multiple vertebral level involvement. How can you end up doing only an anterolateral decompression on this patient? Yes, but at least you should know that costo transversity alone is not sufficient on this patient because the patient has a neurological deficit and you should decompress the spinal cord. So you will do at least an anterolateral decompression. Then, so what is the ideal surgery for this? You know, this procedure, you saw in the MRI that all the posterior elements are intact. It's only the anterior vertebra is affected. So anterior surgery popularized by Hoxton and Stock, which is called the Hong Kong procedure, is the ideal surgery for this patient, which is called the Hong Kong procedure. So what is the principle of an Hong Kong procedure? That means you drain the abscess. It is a thoracotomy. It's an anterolateral thoracotomy where you drain the abscess, debride the necrotic material, decompress the spinal cord, and whatever defect you have is defect grafting. So these are the four D's in a Hong Kong procedure or in a operative management of a TB spine is drainage of abscess, debridement of the necrotic material, decompression of the spinal cord, and defect grafting. The defect graft, you can use iliacus, ribs, fibula. Of late, we are using cages. So you can say, I can use a cage, spacer. But that is not the principle. Don't say, I'll put a cage. So I will do a defect grafting. So that is the terminology is expected. How do you fill the defect grafting is up to you based on the defect and based on your expertise and based on your ideology and belief. Because some people still believe that you should not put implant in a TB spine. Doesn't matter. You put iliacus. But so the word you have to use is defect grafting. Fine. So this is an example where you have done a thoracotomy and you see the vertebral body is nicely debrided. This is the spinal cord in the back and you have put a graft here in the front, iliacus graft. So this is the classical Hong Kong procedure. So this will be good for that patient. This is the procedure you should do for that patient ideally. Okay, at least an anterolateral decompression or preferably an Hong Kong procedure is an anterior decompression. But the problem is, of late we have found after doing an Hong Kong procedure, okay, you have to keep the patients on a bed for a long time because you have taken out multiple ribs, the vertebra there, and you put a large graft there. And if you make the patient sit, sometimes the graft can slip. Okay, or the graft can collapse and the deformity can happen again. Okay, so people started adding instrumentation posteriorly. So it is not wrong to say that I will do an Hong Kong procedure and supplement with a posterior fixation for this patient. So that is an anterior surgery supplemented by a posterior surgery like this. This is not the same patient like where you, when you do an extensive anterior surgery on a TB spine like this. Okay, you can't leave the patient alone with an anterior surgery alone. Then you turn the patient and put a posterior implant, supplementary posterior fixation. So that is also an accepted answer. Okay. Or can we do everything combined in one setup? Yes, that is called the extended posterior circumferential decompression. This is called extended posterior circumferential decompression. So this is what I will do, sir, or probably that is the surgery you might have seen in your place. Okay, this is where the laminectomy is done. So don't tell laminectomy alone. This is where part of the procedure laminectomy is done. In all the other procedures, laminectomy is not done. Either in a costotransversectomy or an anterolateral decompression or in a Hong Kong procedure or a Hong Kong followed by posterior instrumentation, you don't do a laminectomy. Only in this procedure, you do a laminectomy, which is called an extended posterior circumferential decompression. Okay, actually, we from CMC, we published this and we wrote on this back in 2009. So what is this? That means it is a posterior surgical approach where you do a bilateral costotransversectomy, then you do a laminectomy and a retroperitoneal or a retroperitoneal corpectomy based on the levels, circumferential decompression of the cord, then posterior instrumentation with correction of the deformity and interbody spacer under compression. Okay, so if you can tell, sir, I can do an extended posterior circumferential decompression and this is how I do it, fantastic. It is good for your exams. So this is what was done for the patient. You can see all from the back. So that is not important, but what surgery has to be done? What is the principle of surgery? You should know. So finally, the principle of surgery is, this is the principle of surgery. Drain the abscess, debride the spine, necrotic material, decompress the spinal cord, and the resultant defect you have to graft with an iliac crest or a rib or a fibula or a cage. So this is the principle in treating this patient. So yeah. So coming to ATT regimen, I know various people will use various regimens, but off late, the current acceptance is it should not be more than 12 months. So that is a current WHO recommendation for extra pulmonary tuberculosis. Even in your place, if it is given extra, unless your examiner is going to support, please don't comment on more than 12 months of ATT. And definitely the DOTS regime, 6 months, unless you have a valid study from your center, don't quote DOTS study. Okay, if you are from Chennai, where you can quote your center that yes, our center has published that DOTS is sufficient 6 months treatment, don't quote that study. So currently what our publication says, we have to use 9 months treatment. The WHO recommendation is minimum 9 months, but you can go up to 12 months, definitely not more than 12 months. I know there are some senior surgeons who will continue ATT till the MRI shows healing, but there is no scientific validity for it. It is only based on their personal consensus. Okay, all these are based on study. Okay, where we have found that patients who don't need treatment more than 9 months. Okay, so what is the regime you give? You give first line treatment, that is INH, rifampicin, pyrazinamide, and ethambutol. Okay, currently the WHO recommends ethambutol can be continued for 9 months. So three drug regime. So that is the current WHO recommendation. Otherwise, you can say in the intensive phase, I give 4 drugs and maintenance phase, I will give 2 drugs. What are the 4 drugs in intensive phase? INH, rifampicin, pyrazinamide, ethambutol. And maintenance phase, I give INH and rifampicin based on the weight and dose. That's fine. They will always ask, doctor, will you give only these drugs? And you don't add any more drugs, because some of your centers can give levofloxacin and other things. Don't add those drugs. What they are requesting is you have to always add pyridoxine to this. Why pyridoxine? Because INH can cause sensory neuropathy. INH can cause sensory neuropathy because of pyridoxine depletion. So you have to add B6 to it. That is why pyridoxine is added to this. So that is the 5th drug, not the levofloxacin, any other drugs which might be used in a center. So ATT regimen, not more than 12 months. 9 months is a well-accepted regime. You can quote many of our studies and you can say INH is intensive phase for 2 months, maintain for 4 drugs, maintenance days of 2 drugs for the next 7 months. Yes, fine. So what is the follow-up? How do you follow up? Will you stop your treatment there, sir? No, sir. I will follow up this patient at least for 5 years. This is where you finish your examination. Okay, after your discussion. I will follow this patient for at least 5 years. Why, doctor, 5 years? Because the patient can have relapse. The patient can have recurrence. The patient can have deformity progression. If I am treating this patient non-operatively, they can have late onset of paraplegia. And very rarely, implant-related complications can be seen late. So I will follow this patient for at least 5 years. Okay, so that will be your final discussion part if you reach to that level. So this is a small algorithm where you can see with the patients having neurological deficit, when will you treat operatively? When will you treat non-operatively? And if you are doing a operative management or non-operative management, it is available in most of our publications. And this is a guideline. This is not a dictum. This is not a recommendation. I mean, what is a standard of care? This is a recommendation or an option you can have especially for examination, when you are going for an examination to see when you treat them non-operatively, when the patient has neurological deficit. Don't say that I'll wait for middle path regime. Only when the patient has mild deficit like ASIA D, okay, you treat them non-operatively. Otherwise, because the operative techniques are so nice and patients give very good results, for all neurological deficit, even with ASIA B and C, you tend to operate these patients. What type of operation you do, that is different. The patient has minimal disease, you can do an anterolateral decompression. If the patient has significant disease, then you have to add an posterior instrumentation. Okay, so finally, to conclude, I should say, when you qualify as an orthopedic surgeon, TB spine should be managed by every experienced orthopedic surgeon. The only the problems which need complex two-column surgery should be carried out by experienced spinal surgeons or a senior surgeon. Otherwise, the basic TB spine surgical management and diagnosis and non-operative management should be managed by every orthopedic surgeon. It need not go to a spine surgeon. Thank you very much. Sorry, sir.
Sir, thank you, Vagadesh. It was fantastic. Dr. Paresh, please. Would you like to...
You have to unmute, sir. Dr. Paresh, you have to unmute.
Yes. Sir, unmute. Abhi bhi.
Yeah. Okay, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Both of the faculty members, Dr. Mallikarjun and Dr. Venkatesh, have given extensive view of the spine examination as well as how to present the case. The tubercular spine discussion was very extensive, and I think Dr. Venkatesh has covered all the points which can be represented or presented by the student at the time of examination. I thank the IOAPG committee for organizing a complete webinar on spine examination for PG students. Thank you very much. Over to Dr. Raj Gopalan for further comments. Dr. Raj Gopalan.
Thank you, Dr. Paresh. Dr. Venkatesh, it was very, very nice. And, you know, there are some few points where, like you said, what should the students say? The duration has been, as you know, has been a thorn in our thing for many, many years, still not getting solved. And a student goes from one part of the country to another part of the country. I have seen the problem. I don't want to get into that. But one thing what you said, if it is going to be a DNB where you don't have an internal candidate examiner to support your statement, it is better you go by evidence-based medicine. If you are an MS student and you have internal examiner, if you really know what is done in your college, you can definitely say that as a student. Because if I am going to be working under, say, Mallikarjun, and I can definitely say that this is what I do, he will support me. But if I say wrongly, then it's very, very difficult. So that is one thing. So that is one part, because there is still a lot of people who don't, agree for the indications of surgery, even what you have said, because that is their personal view. The student need not worry about it. As long as you are talking about evidence-based medicine, you need not worry. That is number one thing. Number two is the duration. Number three, you have covered everything. There's nothing you have left for us to add. But one thing I want to say, that in the exam, you go only to the details of management, only if the student does well, because not from that as such. Tubercular surgery, everybody should know, but the time factor. The time factor, of course, you can't take a... I'm talking about DNB and MS, not about FNB. Do you expect them to know more than this, Vagadesh?
Not really, sir. At least the principles of surgery, because sometimes, like I have seen, if they are not coming with a good clinical diagnosis, immediately the examiner will get upset and they'll say, okay, put the X-rays on and then put the MRI on. So at that point of time, at least if we can scientifically talk about the principles of surgery, okay, so then there is a chance that he may escape from failure.
So Mallikarjun, what do you feel?
I think you well said, sir, extensively covered by Dr. Venkatesh. Like, I congratulate you, especially the management part. I think this is extensively for FNB candidates, definitely suits. If our DNB or MS candidate knows, is very well. And as you well said about the ATT controversy, can be varies from center to center. And one more thing I want to tell, and Monto test is questionable. As well said by Ankesh, gold quantifier and test is no more recommended by WHO. And one more thing, in MRI findings, one point, I think it's overlooked. Skip lesions, you can always make out. That's the one point is MRI is useful for us. That's all I can tell. Otherwise, very well covered.
Yeah, actually, in my presentation, on the top, I have written as MRI thoracic spine with whole spine screening.
Yeah.
That is mainly to identify skip lesions.
Any spinal pathology, we all prefer whole spine screening. And tuberculosis definitely is useful to make out skip lesions. That's more important.
It's very important.
Well done.
But that point is very important.
Yeah.
Rajesh?
Venkatesh, very nice presentation.
Thank you.
Few points for postgraduates. I think it is very important to read the X-ray properly. So many things can be, you know, diagnosed on only X-ray. So I think the differential diagnosis on X-ray has to be there, you know. The IV space must be seen only on the lateral view. We must mention IV space reduced or not reduced only on the lateral view, not on the AP view. That is one thing. Second thing, you know, you told us, you know, when we look for power in the sitting position, suppose patient is already having paraplegia or paraparesis, should we allow the patient to sit?
Thoracic spine is not very unstable, sir, practically speaking. Still, if the patient can sit with support, it is better. It is not sitting without support. So if the patient is resting on a bed and where we can keep some pillows and make, because most of the time what the students will get, they will get worked up because they will feel that the lower part of the leg is moving. That means ankle 3 and 4, but knee and hip are not moving that much. Okay. So they won't be able to map the neurology. The main problem is because of the pain, he won't be able to lift the leg and the knee. So that is the main thing, which the students will find it very difficult. So in exams also, we should also keep the patients where we can make them sit. If you are concentrating on neurology, if it is going to be a long case, okay, and if the patient is moving the ankle, and I at least 3 or 2 where it is moving, so if the hip is going to be, if he says no, he is not moving the hip because of, and if he says 0, then he won't be able to map the neurology and he will get worked up. So in this, those patients, if you make them sit, they will be able to lift the leg up in knee, in flexed portion of the knee. So as examiners, we also should be very careful.
No, you mean while sitting, you know, pain is less. So they are able to lift.
Yes.
So that is the point.
Or if you are not able to do it, like we should tell them, don't bother about the neurology of the hip. We should tell the students, don't bother about the flexion of the hip.
I think what Dr. Rajesh Gupta sir told is a well valid point practically on the examination hall. Sometimes because of the pain, patient may not able to do.
Yes.
Such situation, you may be risking the patient to sit in the sitting position also. Is well taken. In such situation, we can always candidate say it's very painful, it's very difficult to assess the motor functions. However, distally, ankle and they have grade 3. I think as an examiner, you can accept all those.
And we also should tell the student that this patient, don't make him sit. And we don't, I mean, don't do any motor examination on the hip protection.
And another point is, when we say of, you know, Tully's classification, we say less than 50%, you know, sensory loss.
Can you explain
a bit on that, you know? Everybody is confused on that.
It is purely subjective, less than 50% sensory loss. It is on that whatever sensory loss he has, it is not the overall less than 50%. Okay, it is whatever sensory loss he has should be less than 50% of the normal area.
Okay.
So it is not less than 50% means the cumulative loss. Like if you have 20 segments measured, and it should not be, it is not like the 10 should be less than, it should be less than 10 areas or more than 10 areas. It is the amount of sensation. It is like if you see in Asia, like if it is normal, we write it as 2, the sensation. If it is reduced, we write it as 1. That is the 50%. That means it is partial loss of sensation. It is not actually 50% of the total area.
So otherwise they can use the international guidelines like S0, S1, S2, S3 plus and S4.
Yeah.
If you grade in that level, I think most of the time our students may not read this grading, sensory grading. If they read that, if it is 50% of the sensory loss of this grading, then they are counted as...
See, why I was very interested in Tully's classification is because as orthopedic surgeons, we make them read that book. So, and if we also allow them to examine in the same way how it is given and present in the same way, the orthopedic fraternity will be uniform. Okay, because we tend, because Asia should not be used, I'm telling you, as a surgeon, Asia should not be used for infection. That's and this is a very good classification.
Yeah, for infective pathology, I think Kumar Goyal's or Tully's classification is very good. For trauma, I always prefer Asia.
Yeah, and I think we should resurrect that. We should resurrect that classification, and then we can even we can add some more things. And then as an orthopedic fraternity, we should follow uniformly that classification.
Yes, agree.
And Venkatesh, last question. You know, when we say we have diagnosed the patient on a history examination and done the CBs and all blood investigations and on the, on X-ray. We are sure it is tuberculosis. Should we start the patient on ATT or should we go ahead with the MRI and all those investigations?
Actually, we have a publication on non-operative management. And the only indication where we are not attempting a biopsy is an intraosseous lesion on the MRI. It is very early. So an intraosseous lesions where they cannot do a CT guided biopsy and open open biopsy is too much for the patient, or a transpedicular biopsy where you can try a trial of ATT. With close follow-up, and that falls into less than 1% of the cases. In all the other patients, it is possible to do a CT guided biopsy. And especially in now where the radiology department has become so widened, and intervention radiology is there everywhere, even if it is not in the primary health center, it will be in the upgraded primary health center or in the medical college. So there is hardly few indication where we should not do, because the in our publication back in 2016, the incidence of MDR TB is 2.7%. Okay, the so slowly it is increasing. So even and the critical stage is not 20 or 30%, it's 6%. When you reach that beyond 6%, WHO says it is alarming. That means it can you can even get primary multi-regression tuberculosis. So that means we are halfway through. We have reached almost 3% now. So it is only another 3% before we get a primary de novo MDR-TB. And in that, when we get that, and if we still start going to treat with primary ATT, empirical ATT, we can run into trouble. So it is high time as orthopedic surgeons and spine surgeons that we should start doing CT-guided procedures on these patients or an ultrasound-guided procedure on these patients to come to a microbiological diagnosis. Because if you get even a small sample on an active disease, the chances of expert TB positive, the sensitivity we have quoted is around 87%. So 87% you are going to get a positive result. And in the expert, you will know also whether it is rifampicin sensitive or not. And the specificity is 100%, especially for MDR. If the expert says that the rifampicin is resistant, it is always resistant. So, and it is possible to do it in most of the centers, and we should encourage that. I know in many centers it may not be possible, but still we should encourage them to send it to the next center and at least get the diagnosis confirmed and bring back the patient for treatment.
Actually, well said by Venkatesh. All we have to put all our effort to get a tissue diagnosis. That's a must. That's more important. Yes.
One thing is definitely the MDR is increasing in it. So we have to be legally also looking into it. I think that it's a must that one should attempt. The question is sometimes you fail. That is a few percentage of that. That is where the question comes in. What?
Sir, one is that to know the tissue diagnosis, MDR, SDR, but at the same time you don't know, you may run in brucellosis. That's most very close diagnosis.
Yes.
It may be responsive to streptomycin like some of the ATT drug also. But you cannot keep on giving for 9 months and 12 months in such situation. I think you are justified scientifically by doing biopsy all cases.
Great.
Another thing, Venkatesh, about the duration, no? This is probably what I'm saying is not relevant today, but in the days before we had so much investigations, I still remember a patient that was there when Malli was with me. We had a patient and we gave ADT, he had multiple sinuses, the earlier days, multiple sinuses, cold abscess, burst, like, none of them healed, none of them healed. 6 months, 8 months, he didn't heal. So, I mean, we lost time unnecessarily. If we have facilities those days to do that, so we have started him on alternative drugs and he would have been all right much earlier. So that is one. Identification early is going to be very, very important. So I think it's worth doing that. Okay, I think it's 8:30 now. We have come to the thing. I will request Dr. Rajesh to give us the water first.
Sir, before that, I just want to know from, Shamshal or Neeraj, if he's here, or Ashok, how many participants are there in this, webinar, I don't know. We are discussing among us ourselves, but there is no question from the participants.
Actually, I noticed this, and Dr. Vijay from our side is there, and other two people, I don't know. So, four participants, extra participants are there, four participants.
That is all right. But I just want to know from those people, how many are in attendance today? How much is the attendance today? Are they here?
Yeah, they should be here. Vijay or...
Neeraj or Shamshal or Ashok, are they here with us?
Yeah,
because it is very important, sir. If we keep on discussing among us to 9 people, there is no fun, with these PG webinars. I'm thinking about this for quite few weeks now.
I totally agree with you, Rajesh. But before answering that, I would like to have the number. And yes. I think Shamshal, are you there? Okay.
Last time also I wanted to ask this. I don't know. Yes, I think later they can tell us. There's a because they have the numbers.
Yeah, I also noticed that today the number is much lesser than even last time, because the number is going to be something, going to be less than 2 digits. That's what it looks like.
Sir, the number here are only of the faculty, I think.
No, faculty won't come in the participants.
Then it is only 9 or 10, sir. Yes. It means no PG is attending.
Yes, sir, I do not know. That's what I want to know from him. To my knowledge, at least 12 people have logged in from Pondicherry alone. So I'm not able to understand.
It must be reflecting here. I don't know. Because we distribute, sir, I put in all the groups. I put in all the groups, whenever it is there. So in the morning today, I put in all the groups of the IUA.
I saw yours. I have been contacting personally the people in and around. So, as I said, only I also can't make out from here how many people who have logged in. But, you are right. The participants here are only the invites. So, yes. I don't know. We have to find out from this thing.
We'll discuss with them later on.
Yeah, we'll discuss with them. But the only other thing, Rajesh, I want to say, quite a few people are seeing the recorded item, because today, right now, there are 2-3 programs going on, one which is the president is there. And so students also, and Saturday we would have more students. Now that we shifted to Friday, that has also decreased the students. These are two, I find. Number third, the recorded versions are still useful for postgraduates.
Is all right, sir. Recorded versions are okay, sir. But then interaction is not there, na? Interaction is not there. Recorded is okay. But
I think what Rajesh Gupta, sir, is telling is a valid point, sir. I think sir can take the decision. I think, sir, I got some work if you permit me. Sir.
Mali, I know Rajesh Rajkumar is standing there behind you.
He wants to Mali, talk to you, sir.
Hi, Rajkumar.
Sir, excuse me, sir. Can I take leave? I have to attend the ASICON.
We have to thank Shamshal, Neeraj, and Ashok for giving us the opportunity to use their platform for, Artho DV to host the webinars. Thank you very much.
This
is it. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, Vangadesh. Thank you, Malli. Thank you, Malli Rajan. Thank you, Rajkumar. Okay, Rajesh, stay back.
Yeah, I'm here.
Thank you.
I think some should be.
Yeah, Shamsul is busy. Venkatesh, you can leave. Malli, you can leave.
Yeah.
Shamsul, can we go off the line?
Shamsul is there.
Shamsul, can we go off the line? Can we stop the recording?
I think he has to unmute. Shamsul, please unmute. Yeah. I think Ashok is also here. It's a Galaxy.
Yeah, he's there. But nobody's answering.
Yeah. So, sir, you can take the matter with them, you know, later on. I think.
Okay, we'll discuss later. Because, you know, Rajesh, I also was thinking, last time also you raised this issue. And today I also was thinking that either we have to increase the thing or we have to probably reduce the meeting. Because there are too many meetings. I agree with you.
Otherwise, what is the fun keeping on talking about the among us locality?
Totally, I agree with you, because last month, what you told me, I kept on thinking in my mind. Even I was planning to discuss this in our group. What I will do, Rajesh, we will discuss it in our committee group first, and then sir, go to the IOA group.
Sir, you arrange a Zoom meeting someday for 10-15 minutes.
With the president and office bearers, have a meeting. Other thing is, we have only 3 meetings left. September, October, November.
No, we can do the meetings. There is no problem. We can continue with the meetings. Whatever meetings we are doing, we are okay with it. But then there has to be participation from the PG side. That is the main issue, you know. We are doing for them. And if the people are not interested, that is a big concern.
Very true. I will take it up, sir.
Yes, sir. You fix up a meeting first, then we'll discuss again, right?
Okay, Rajesh. Thank you so much, Rajesh. Bye-bye. Good night. Thank you, Shamsul. Thank you. Ashok. Thank you all.
I don't know. They are not online,
I think they are probably with some other meeting.
There's
a meeting going on in Jharkhand.
Yeah.
Maybe with that.
Maybe. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Okay, Rajesh. Bye-bye. Good night.